Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. Live from Austin, Texas, broadcasting worldwide, it's Alex Jones.
Now, going to David Icke, we're going to play this clip again. It's very short. I'm sure David's seen it, but I haven't asked him. But here's one of the clips. This is a couple hours after the shooting Saturday, and they talk about Ayn Rand. They talk about another author, and then they go after David Icke for conscious dreaming, which I haven't really heard David talk much about. Now they're blaming me for the conscious dreaming because I'm in the film Waking Life, a Richard Linklater film that is about that. I mean, this is crazy now. If you talk about daydreaming, you're now going to cause mass murder. Let's go ahead and play that clip.
This man also talked quite a lot in these strange videos of his about what he called conscience dreaming, but I think is almost certainly meant to be conscious dreaming, which is an idea that also has been kind of tossed around on the radical right, in particular by a kind of British conspiracy theorist by the name of David Icke. So a lot of these ideas, his burning of the flag, his talking about the government as treasonous, and using mind control to control
that's
the
enough.
Rest of us. And
no, he was talking in class about could he be under mind control. David Icke, we now learned that they knew he was death-threatening people and were doing nothing. That's Reuters. We now know the media kept asking Giffords over and over again, nationally and locally, is somebody going to kill you? Is somebody going to get you? Pretty much triggering this guy. They can program people who are unstable now through the television. They don't even need to grab you. You're an expert in this mind control, David, and they're now coming after you. Let's get into what you think of this shooting and all the rest of it.
Well, the fact that they're coming after me is makes me delighted, because if I'm rattling their cage, then I'm doing something right. The whole scenario is ludicrous, but perfectly predictable, because we've reached a point now where they are so desperate to push this agenda forward as fast as possible before the wake-up that's happening gets to a point where it brings it to an end. But the excuses now are getting more and more ludicrous. They're not even paying lip service to any even fake substance. Someone burns his bum on some small little device on a plane, and suddenly everyone's getting radiated every day in America in full-body scanners, thanks to people like Michael Chertoff, former head of Homeland Security and co-author of the Patriot Act. And now we have this situation where either one of the two, a guy who became mentally ill and mentally deranged from some sort of natural process, or quite possibly, because it's happening on an incredible scale, a manipulated, implanted process, it goes crazy with a gun, and immediately, on cue, just like when 9/11 happened, they were talking about Bin Laden immediately, the next stage of the whole thing unfolds where they're using it, and I have to say, I am so utterly disgusted and repulsed that these people can have such, be so shameless, to have no heart, no compassion, no sense of decency, that they can use an horrific event involving the death of a 9-year-old child, among many others, to push their political agenda, to defame and try to discredit those that are uncovering the very cabal that controls them. It turns my stomach. It makes me puke. This is the level of soulless, compassionless lack of empathy that we're dealing with the people that are pushing this agenda now.
It is just horrific to see this unfolding. Now, you've written extensively in the last 17, 18 years about Satanism and why we see it at Skull and Bones, Bohemian Grove, why we see it involved with almost every serial killer, especially those that go after children, altars. I called him as a Satanist instantly when I started reading about it Saturday, but on air Sunday, then Monday morning, yesterday, the Newark Daily News and others had somebody sneak in his backyard. There was a full-bore tent, an altar. The family obviously knew about it. They're described as the Adams family by locals. Now their house is boarded up. I think the whole group needs to be investigated. But over and over again, and you've done deep research on this, there is extreme Satanism. But as you've proven, it's used as a template for mind control. And former FBI LA division directors that we've had on this show have gone over that as well. I mean, what's going on with this Satanism?
Well, you know, as I've written and talked about extensively, not least recently, the three points of the monster, if you like, in terms of this area that we're talking about are Satanism, mind control and secret societies, and pedophilia. And those all work as one unit. It's not saying every Freemason's a Satanist, every Satanist is a Freemason. Every Freemason's a pedophile, every pedophile is a Satanist. But there is a massive connection between them, not least in the way they use techniques, not only, Alex, to mind control people and get them to act, react, and perceive in the way that they're programmed to, but also, and we've talked about this before, it's about getting people possessed by very malevolent entities. That's what Satanism and satanic ritual and manipulation is overwhelmingly about. It's about putting another malevolent consciousness in control of that person's body so it reacts and behaves in line with that malevolent entity. It's no accident, mate, that they've been talking about possession for hundreds and thousands of years in every culture, and they're still talking about it today.
And if you look at Loeffner, you can't fake that. I mean, he looks like he's demon-possessed. And for those that are atheists or whatever, even if you don't believe this stuff, notice that atheism, in many cases, in his case, then leads to this occult voodoo with a skull and the oranges and the altar. That's what that is, ladies and gentlemen. And what is voodoo? Voodoo is possession by the spirits, and he was there wanting to be possessed, and I've researched voodoo. That's what that ritual is with a skull, by the top hat wearing skull or the devil in voodoo. He was asking to be possessed by the devil. That's basic criminology, and the key here is the globalists believe in this. When I infiltrated Bohemian Grove, they asked for the spirits of old Grovers to be there. They asked for the spirit of Moloch to enter them on videotape. I mean, even if you don't believe in spirits, folks, these people do. David Icke.
Well, the fact is, and I've talked to former Satanists all over the world over the last 20 years in my research of this, the hierarchy of Satanism is dictated by the power of the demons that possess you. That's why Satan is seeking more and more power and more status within these networks, are constantly seeking more and more powerful demonic entities to take them over. That's why some of the most demonically possessed people end up in the positions within the conspiracy, within politics and banking and business and military and all these things, media. And therefore, it's no accident that all those operations working as one unit treat the world and control the world with such lack of empathy, lack of decency, lack of soul, lack of compassion, and it's everything is what is best for them, and the consequences for others are irrelevant. But there's another aspect to this which has to be spoken about if we're going to understand the Southern Poverty Law Center. It works with a network of organizations like the Anti-Defamation League and Abe Foxman, the Simon Wiesenthal Center, the American Jewish Committee, and others. And it's a network which is designed, and it answers ultimately to the House of Rothschild, designed to target anyone who gets too close to the truth about the conspiracy, to dub them racist, to dub them right-wing, to dub them terrorists, and potentially violent. And this is what's happening now. The Southern Poverty Law Center, I mean, where the hell the poverty comes from, Alex, I don't know. It's got assets of $200 million. Mark Potok, this guy, Botox, whatever his name is, $144,000 a year. The president and CEO, Richard Cohen, $351,000 a year. On it goes and on it goes. It's a money-making organization, which, like the Defamation League, something like $50 million a year in fundraising. It uses fear and it uses the threat of the far right to get people to fund it to enormous amounts of money and to keep that funding going and also to do the job its masters put these organizations.
And then they train the police, and then they train the police.
People and dub anyone getting close to the truth as far right and all the rest of it that has been coming out since this terrible event in Arizona.
But, I mean, now they're attacking you, Ayn Rand. I mean, what's so threatening about Ayn Rand?
Well, what's threatening about anybody, Alex, is if they're getting close to uncovering the truth. And it is no accident whatsoever that they've turned their attentions to me. These groups had me in their sights back in the 90s when they were trying to get venues to ban me from speaking and succeeded in places like Canada. But because what they were saying about me and what I say publicly, what I write, what I stand for are so ludicrously different and opposed, it didn't stick. And this won't stick either. It's desperation. But it's no accident that on New Year's Day, I put out a major, major expose article across the internet. You can get it on my website. It's called They Dare Not Speak Its Name, Rothschild Zionism, pointing out that Zionism is not about the benefiting Jewish people. It's on its play out level, it's only a political philosophy. But the key point, Alex, is at its core, it is a secret society created by the Rothschilds, controlled by the Rothschilds, and it's there for the benefit not of Jewish people, many of whom incidentally fundamentally oppose Zionism, or Rothschild Zionism as I call it. It's there to serve the Rothschild, Illuminati, Rockefeller, subordinates to the Rothschilds' agenda. And therefore, these organizations have seen that, where I show the staggering ratio of Rothschild Zionist agents in government in key positions before, during, and after 9/11, etc. And suddenly that goes out, and bingo, they start turning their attentions on me through the Southern Poverty Law Center. I'm delighted because it means it's having an effect. And if they think they're going to shut me up, well, they can try for the rest of their lives. It ain't going to happen. We have to stand up to these people, and we have to open our eyes to some of the agendas and the people behind them and what's really going on. All these organizations, Alex, the Anti-Defamation League, Southern Poverty Law Center, Simon Wiesenthal Center, they all say they're human rights organizations when they are taking away human rights and even helping to write legislation to take away basic human rights. The Anti-Defamation League actually makes its money and also does its business by defaming people. It's Orwellian.
No, I know. They're constantly attacking yours truly. We got to go to break, David. We'll come back and continue along this line and get back also into the mass shooting and where you see this going.